will be. Good evening and welcome. We will begin with some breaking news. Just in the last little while, in a huge announcement, the government has promised a pension of 3,000 rupees for all farmers monthly, something that they can access after the age of 60. We will talk about that in a while. But yesterday at this time, if you tuned into the news, you may have been expecting to know the names of the big ministerial appointments in Modi 2.0. But now, almost a day later, we finally have them, and they are big. This is the full list. We'll tell you about some of the major ones over here. We have a new Home Minister, a new Finance Minister, a new Defence Minister, a new External Affairs Minister. The changes are profound. My colleague Sanket Upadhyay and me are going to go through a lot of the major points, and there are so many points, I don't think we can manage in 1 hour or so, but we're going to try and get through as many as we can. The changes are profound on this show. What do the big appointments, particularly the appointment of Amit Shah as Home Minister, mean? Yes, he is the de facto number two in the government, but what can we now expect in our country? The changes are huge, possibly. Well, as Modi 2.0 held its first cabinet meeting, there was bad news on the economic front. GDP growth rate numbers are out and GDP growth rate is down, primarily because of a major slowdown in the agriculture sector and in the mining sector. Nirmala Sitharaman, the new finance minister, will need to hit the road running to make a serious dent in fixing the problems, and there are many of them. But before we tell you about the big four posts in some more detail, here are images of the Prime Minister at his office, placing petals at the idol of the Mahatma. Let's have those images of the Prime Minister at his office, placing those petals of the Mahatma. We'll try and bring that up in a while from now. He had his first cabinet meeting today, and the job ahead of the new cabinet is immense. You can see images of the Prime Minister over there. That's where he places some petals, the image at an idol of the Mahatma. And earlier, you saw some images of that cabinet meeting as well. Well, as I mentioned, the big announcement that's been made, 3,000 rupees for all farmers monthly in a pension. They can access this at the age of 60. And they can apply for it between the ages of 18 and 14. But let's take a look first at the big portfolios. And there you have it on your screen. Amit Shah, the BJP president. Big question, does he remain the BJP president? Because he is also now the Home Minister of the country, de facto number two in the country. What are the changes which he wants to bring about? That's important because he has said a lot on the election campaign. Let's take a look at the other one. The biggest elevation, some would argue, Sanket, is that of Nirmala Sitharaman. She was a BJP spokesperson, she was the defense minister of the country, and now two huge posts, corporate affairs and, of course, the finance ministry. We've also got a wonderful and a very interesting addition in Mr. Jaishankar. Mr. Jaishankar, let's have those big four graphics if we can. Mr. Jaishankar, the external affairs minister, somebody who's worked very, very closely with Prime Minister Modi and the National Security Advisor. He was foreign secretary. He got an extension. He retired. He joined the Tatas. Mm-hmm. And he's right back, this time replacing Sushma Swaraj as the external affairs minister of the country. And Rajnath Singh, who was number two in a sense as Home Minister, now moves to the Defence Ministry. So what's the big message here? Sanket Upadhyay joins me. Sanket, let's first, and we'll bring in our panelists in a moment, let's just look at point number one. Amit Shah being projected as the de facto number two in the regime. He's always been a big boss in the BJP, president of the BJP, but in terms of him coming into the government in this post, what does it mean?
Well, it means that there is a natural succession plan, which means Narendra Modi has clearly thought of his number two as far as governance is concerned. See, party is different from government. Party means managing party affairs. But managing the government means that in the absence of Modi, who this time around would perhaps be busier in projecting India at the international map, right? This may entail more travel for the Prime Minister, maybe. At that moment, who handles the affairs back home?
Right.
It's Mr. Amit Shah.
All right. Well, let's also take a look at a few more points related to Amit Shah. Now, internally at one level within the BJP, this is being lauded. He is being lauded as India's new Sardar Patel even before he's actually kicked off his work. But the BJP sees it in this manner.
Absolutely. I mean, internally, many spokespersons, many youth workers in the BJP feel that this is the Sardar Patel. You know what their hope is? Their hope is that left-wing extremism will end with Amit Shah. At the, whether it happens or not, I don't know. But there is a natural expectation within the BJP. Amit Shah is there. A left-wing extremism will end. The Kashmir problem will be solved. And terrorism will be controlled.
Okay.
So these are the three big expectations his elevation has brought about.
Okay. Point number three, the National Register of Citizens. We've seen the impact it's had in Assam, parts of the Northeast. Is it now going to be enforced in other states of the country? Ought also Article 35A and Article 370 specific to Kashmir? In fact, let me just introduce our panel at this stage. We are joined by the former IAS officer, Shah Faisal. Smita Prakash also joins us, editor of ANI, Lalita Kumaramangalam of the BJP. And we are very fortunate, very privileged to have the former Foreign Secretary, Nirupama Rao, with us as well. Let me come to you, Mr. Faisal, first. You know, on the election trail and in terms of rhetoric over the last several months, we've heard about a change in the status of Kashmir being invoked. Article 35A, the right of permanent residence in Kashmir. Do you believe that this government is intent in changing this? I mean, the way how they do this constitutionally, I don't know. But do you believe that this is something that they may attempt to do?
I think if you go by what has been written in the manifesto, then there is very little to reassure us that these articles will not go. But then at the same time, as you said it very correctly, that BJP is projecting Mr. Amit Shah as the next Sardar Patel, then at the same time, we have to understand that these articles, Article 370 and 35A, these are articles of Sardar Patel's vintage. Mm-hmm. They were incorporated into the constitution at a time when Sardar Patel was there. So we are hopeful that the executive responsibility and the pressure of the chair, or maybe when you finally come on the table and come on the chair and understand the ground realities, you know, being in party is a separate case. But now that Mr. Amit Shah is heading the department, I hope he will realize the, you know, the pressures of the ground situation and understand that these articles do not need to be tinkered with. And if he really wishes to be remembered as the next Sardar Patel, then it would be rather well for them to respect what has been promised to the people of Jammu and Kashmir in the constitution.
Okay, Lalita Kumaramangalam, you heard what Shah Faisal had to say over there. But in terms of dealing with the situation in Jammu and Kashmir, there is one set of thinkers within the BJP who believe that the lack of residency rights for people from other parts of the country in Kashmir is a stumbling block. If people are allowed over there, if there are intermingling of different people, if outside businesses are brought in, then a lot of the insurgency which we see in the Kashmir Valley would go away. Therefore, realistically, do we see a profound change with Amit Shah and Kashmir?
Vishnu, I don't think that you should say that if this change is really needed or if many of us in the BJP feel that way, that it should be attributed to Amit Shah coming into the government. Remember that Amit Shah has also been in governance and in government in the state of Gujarat. Yes, he's a genius at organizational work and we will definitely miss him in the party, but he is always there to advise and guide us in the party too. With regard to Kashmir, it is a fact that insurgency, whether it's in, you know, in Kashmir or any other part of India or the world, development, genuine development, if it can be brought in, jobs brought in, education levels increased, and several other developmental indicators can be improved in a place where there's insurgency, automatically insurgency does come down. Because development is probably the only thing that can wean people away from the sort of behavior that unfortunately too many youth are falling prey to, especially with terrorists always coming over from Pakistan.
All right.
Having said that, let's also remember that Amit Shah was an extraordinarily efficient man, both
But how exactly
and
does Amit Shah...
And he's not
Mrs.
Kumaramangalam,
how exactly
person.
Does Amit Shah intend to change the constitution? It's not going to be something very easy. These are parts of the constitution which are not meant to be tinkered with, the special status. How legally, constitutionally does he manage to do this? Assuming it's something which even needs to be
done. Vishnu, I think that we're jumping ahead of the gun.
Okay.
We're jumping to conclusions here. I made a statement which is a fact. But I'm not saying what is going to be done or what can or cannot be done. All of that we'll we'll see unfold over a period of time.
Okay.
I think it's been made very clear by the Prime Minister, both in his speech in Parliament, when he was elected leader of the BJP and of the NDA, and later on and today, where we have made it very clear that it's the economics of the situation, the current situation, prevailing situation in India, which is going to get our first attention. Yes, we've said sabka saath, sabka visath, sabka saath, sabka vikas and sabka vishwas, but that doesn't mean that we are not going to look at the developmental indicators of perhaps a slowdown in the economy.
Okay, ma'am, we're going to talk about the economy in just a moment from now, ma'am, but I want to actually go through a few more points and bring in Sanket on this as well. Messaging as far as portfolios are concerned. And the point over here, Arun Jaitley, unfortunately, very unwell. Sushma Swaraj hasn't been in the best of health either. Two tall legacy leaders of the BJP are missing. Is this advantage or disadvantage, Narendra Modi? Is he adapting to it? I think the loss of Arun Jaitley as a minister would be huge. But what is the thinking? They need to adapt to change?
Vishnu, this leadership of Narendra Modi and Amit Shah is one thing that can safely be said about them. They did lack experience in 2014, but they learned really fast. Mm. And now they're dictating their own rules. So in that sense, yes, it'll be a bit of a setback because Arun Jaitley knew how, he knew Delhi.
Yep.
He knew how governance works.
Yep.
And that was a great advantage. Why else do you think the Prime Minister would break away from protocol and go late in the night to Arun Jaitley's house to convince him that please stay on, I need your help.
Okay.
But of course his health is failing him and that is why he's not along. So it will be a disadvantage slightly, but this man is a fast learner.
Okay, corporate style governance in this cabinet. Performers have been retained, including some like Hardeep Puri, who actually lost the election, but he's been brought back, a few others also. Performers have been retained, non-performers have been removed. Smita Prakash, let me come to you on this particular point. How is the success of this government or the thinking perhaps of the BJP that, look, if you've done well, you are in. If you've not done well, then you are out, irrespective of you know what sort of reputation you may have. How is this part of the selection of these ministers?
I agree with what Sanket has to say that, you know, there seems to be some kind of a stock taking that must have been done, very typical of the BJP, where they have report cards for all their ministers who work, you know, who have been doing in the past 5 years. When it was 2014, you know, Modi needed some hand-holding as far as how Delhi works is concerned. And that is why you saw a major role being played by Jaitley, Sushma Swaraj, Rajnath Singh, to explain to him how bureaucracy functions, how Delhi works. Even for external affairs, he needed that hand-holding. But 5 years, he knows how it is, how things are to be done. So even though their role will be missed in 2019, going forward for the next 5 years, they have the role, they have the roadmap totally mapped out. Now, those the technocrats who have been brought in, as you say, these are people who have worked in the bureaucracy. They know how the systems work. So it's not as if they've been brought out from the private sector. These are people very much within the government who have been used. They may not be politicians, but they are part of the bureaucracy. So they know how systems will go into place and how things are to be put into action. Okay. Even as far as foreign policy is concerned, or, you know, or even the even Home Ministry, which you were talking about, Amit Shah was the go-to man for Modi when he was chief minister.
Right.
And now he will be the go-to man. The economy is extremely important. And to kickstart that, he needs internal stability.
Okay.
He needs peace in Kashmir. So it's not as if he's going to ram down 35A or 370 or the NRC.
All right. That's an important point that you raised. Stability in the country, security needs to be looked at holistically. But another key aspect in this, and a wonderful addition, the lateral entry of Dr. S. Jaishankar as foreign minister of the country, it clearly establishes a trio of the national security advisor, the external affairs minister, the prime minister's office. Nirupama Rao, former foreign secretary, joins us. How is this, ma'am, so very important for continuing what this government set about as a mission with three individuals, the NSA, the new EAM and the Prime Minister, having worked so closely together in the past?
Well, I think it augurs well for for the future direction and operation of foreign policy. There's no doubt about that. And also one must remember that for the last 5 years, a certain approach has been delineated in regard to the neighborhood as well as relations with the world outside. And I expect that continuum to be carried forward. And the fact that Dr. Jaishankar, as Foreign Secretary, had worked closely with the NSA and, of course, developed a close rapport with the Prime Minister and worked together with him, I believe that is a good start, a good point at which to start Modi 2.0. So in that sense, I think the constellation is just right.
And ma'am, just tell us a little bit about what Dr. Jaishankar brings to the table. Obviously, he's been Foreign Secretary, but he's also worked within the system in a very deep manner. I mean, not just as a Foreign Secretary, but perhaps more of an advisor to the Prime Minister in so many ways. How has he become someone the Prime Minister has realized that he cannot do without?
As somebody observed, I read somewhere today that the choice was an inspired one, in the sense that the Prime Minister has picked out Dr. Jaishankar to man the portfolio of the Ministry of External Affairs is certainly an inspired choice, and it is, I believe, a good choice to make under the circumstances. He's not a politician, he hasn't been a member of a political party, but he has been a member of a covenanted branch of the civil service. He brings a lot of experience, 40 years of experience to the subjects that the Ministry of External Affairs deals with. And he enjoys the trust and the confidence of the Prime Minister. That was very clear during his tenure as Foreign Secretary. And the experience that Dr. Jaishankar brings to the table obviously concerns the big neighborhood relationships, the relationship with the United States. And he's been able to deal with these issues in a very granular, textured manner. It's not just, you know, that he's handled all these subjects. He's actually worked on them at junior levels too. So in a sense, he has grown into this position in a very organic way.
All right. Well, let's just take a look at the rise of S. Jaishankar, who will now be the External Affairs Minister, who is now the External Affairs Minister of the country.
He was India's Foreign Secretary, and now he's the big boss. S. Jaishankar took charge as India's External Affairs Minister with his MEA colleagues by his side. As Foreign Secretary from 2015 to 2018, Mr. Jaishankar was one of Mr. Modi's most trusted aides on foreign policy. He steered India closer to the United States and was key in bringing India closer to Arab countries and Japan. A former envoy to the US and China, Jaishankar was also an architect of India-US nuclear deal under Prime Minister Manmohan Singh. As he takes over his ministerial role, the immediate challenges before Jaishankar are balancing India's ties with the United States and Iran over sanctions which have hit India's oil imports, strengthening ties with China. Prime Minister Modi is to meet China's Xi Jinping in June, and handling Pakistan. Prime Minister Modi and Imran Khan will come face to face mid-June in Bishkek at a multilateral summit.
The appointment of Dr. Jaishankar as Foreign Minister also means that National Security Advisor Ajit Doval is no longer the single point person on security and strategic matters. So this space will be an interesting one to watch. Nidhi Razdan for NDTV.
Well, the first cabinet meeting is now taking place. It started a couple of hours back, Sanket, I believe. Let's just go across to some video that we have of that cabinet meeting. And a very important announcement has been made, a pension scheme for farmers. But let's listen in.
सूची आने का सवाल है, तो स्वाभाविक रूप से मैंने पूर्व में भी किसी मित्र ने प्रश्न किया था, तब मैंने कहा था कि कुछ राज्य ऐसे हैं जो समय पर सूची नहीं भेज पाए, उस राज्य के किसान वंचित हो गए. मुझे पूरी आशा है कि वो अब जल्दी से जल्दी सूची भेजेंगे, जिससे कि पूरे 14.5 करोड़ किसानों को इस योजना का लाभ मिले.
सर
तो See, today, what is the summary? Summary is on the very first day, Modi government has started taking important decisions and fulfill its commitments. Jo humne vaade kiye aur jo humne ghoshna patra mein, sankalp patra mein kaha, uska amal aaj se hi shuru hua. Aaj 24 ghante bhi nahi hue shapath grahan ko aur 24 ghante ke andar pehli meeting hoke itne landmark char nirnay liye gaye aur sansad bulane ka bhi faisla hua. ये अहम है. ऐसी गति भारत ने शायद कभी कभार देखी या नहीं देखी है और इसलिए ये इसका महत्व है.
तोमर सर, एक सवाल यहाँ पर ये आता है कि बीमा की जो राशि होगी वो बीमा की राशि किसान किसे देंगे, सरकार किसे देगी, क्या प्राइवेट बीमा कंपनी को देगी या सरकार कोई बीमा कंपनी अपनी बनाएगी उसे बीमा की राशि दी जाएगी?
LIC इसको पूरा व्यवस्था करे.
ओके, थैंक यू वेरी मच लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन. विल गिव यू द प्रेस रिलीजेस एंड इट विल हेल्प यू. थैंक यू.
All right, the cabinet has cleared a 3,000 rupee a month pension for traders as well. So that's also something that's come in. It's not just for farmers, it's for traders as well. So that's one of the big developments at that cabinet meeting. 3,000 pension scheme had earlier been announced for farmers, which they'd be able to get at the age of 60 if they applied between the ages of 18 to 40. So that's a monthly amount that they would be able to get. Over and above that, there is now that announcement which was made over there of a pension scheme for traders as well. For retailers, a pension scheme has been started. And the point being mentioned over here is that all of these decisions are being made quickly, with the government starting out as soon as possible. There are other decisions as well. We'll bring you some details of that in a while from now. I want to go back to Shah Faisal for a little bit. Mr. Faisal, these two announcements, a pension scheme for traders, for retailers, and also for farmers, an amount of 3,000 rupees which can be collected when they're 60 years of age, assuming that they apply when they're between the ages of 18 and 40. How substantive is this?
I think these are two critical governance interventions which have been made, because they do benefit the poorest of the poor people in the country. Farmers have seen a lot of distress in recent years, and I think this is a very, very critical and important intervention which has been made. But at the same time, I would maybe revert back to the discussion about Jammu and Kashmir, that the people of Jammu and Kashmir do expect a lot more from this government. We do know that the BJP has got an overwhelming mandate from the people of India, and that mandate needs to be respected. But our expectation, I think, from the government of India is that the security situation in the state will improve. Maybe the human rights situation in the state will improve. Okay. We will see less number of provocations now when it comes to Article 35A and Article 370. Maybe a new phase of development can start in the state. A new phase of reconciliation will start. We are expecting a lot more critical and maybe more important initiatives vis-a-vis the Jammu and Kashmir state also from the government of India in coming days.
Mrs. Rao, one quick question to you. You know, when we look at national security, often there's been this divide. There is national security from the Defense Ministry standpoint, then there's internal security from the Home Ministry standpoint. The fact is that all of these leaders, whether it's Jaishankar, Rajnath Singh, whether it's Amit Shah and Ajit Doval, and of course the Prime Minister, they would you agree that they would now look at security more cohesively as one unit, in a part of which of course is Kashmir, and what Shah Faisal was actually mentioning over there, that we would now have the opportunity of dealing with national security, international and national, in a more cohesive manner because of the actors who are involved in taking decisions?
I can't hear.
All right, I'm sorry. Smita, did you hear that question? Can I get an answer from you on that?
Yeah. Look, idealistically, that would be the perfect thing to do, where national security is something that everybody agrees on, whether in government or out of government, whether every wing of government agrees that this has to be priority. And unless we crack down on any kind of separatism, terrorism, internal insurgencies, unless all that is tackled, we cannot expect that rural distress can be tackled, that agriculture can be tackled, that your farm income, all these things, you know, for everything to move forward, for the economy to kickstart. Unless we have internal security and unless we have, peace in Jammu and Kashmir, in Northeast and in the Naxal infested areas, unless all that happens, we really cannot move forward. So idealistically, everybody should be on the same page. But when it actually comes down to the grassroots level, it is very difficult to implement. Now, it is for Modi 2.0 to see to it that everybody does work in a cohesive manner. So if he has this team in place where you have, as Nirupama said, that you have Jaishankar who's worked on a granular level, and as Nidhi pointed out, you had Doval who has worked with Jaishankar, and then you have Amit Shah who has been seeing it from a party perspective. If all of them get together, and Rajnath who brings a lot of experience to the table, okay. If all of them sit together and if they have a single perspective, they should be able to deliver in this term.
All right, well, I'm going to take a short break at this stage. We're going to continue looking at the broader picture in terms of the ministerial berths, also mention some of the other ones. And then part two of this program where we look at the state of the economy. GDP numbers are out, they're not encouraging. Agricultural growth numbers are out, they're not encouraging. Employment numbers are out. There are big challenges there as well. If we look at that, bring in more panelists. Stay tuned, more coming. Well, just some news coming in now. We will talk about Rajnath Singh as Defence Minister in a little while from now. But I'm told, in fact, it's official now. I've got the notification copy that Sanjay Mitra, the Defence Secretary, has got an extension as well for a period of 3 months. So he would obviously guide the new Defence Minister, Rajnath Singh. We'll talk about that in a little while from now. Very, very key player in the Defence Ministry. But Nirmala Sitharaman, who till the other day was the Defence Minister of the country, what an incredible growth trajectory she has had. I keep saying this over and over again. I'll say it again. A BJP spokesperson, the Defence Minister of the country, and now the Finance Minister of the country. And it's not just that. She's handling the Ministry of Corporate Affairs as well. So a huge responsibility for her. It's a calculated risk in a sense, a mega elevation and an experiment, some would say. Let's just go back to Lalitha Kumaramangalam on this. Ma'am, the elevation of the new minister is Nirmala Sitharaman is obviously huge. It clearly indicates a lot of trust by the Prime Minister and the BJP President on her abilities.
Yes, absolutely, Vishnu. But I would say that trust has been earned. Nirmalaji's rise has been meteoric, but let's not forget that every ministry she was given, she handled it well, and equally importantly, she always handled it as a team member. There was no conflict with anybody else with whom she had to work, whether it was within the party or the government. And that is a very, very important trait in a team member. Also, Nirmalaji is an extremely well-educated person, very balanced. And as I said, she doesn't play politics, even though she is a part of the party right from the time when she was an NCW member, before she became spokesperson in this government. She always did her job extremely well. So I think it's a very deserved rise, and I'm very happy because she's also from my state. She's from Tamil Nadu, and I feel very proud that, you know, we have a Tamilian woman at the helm of the finance ministry today. Hats off to her and my most sincere congratulations to her. I'm sure she'll do a very good job.
All right. Let's just take a look, in fact, at some of the mega challenges that she faces, Nirmala Sitharaman faces in this new avatar as the finance minister of the country. She's done reasonably well as defense minister, but the finance ministry at a time when even today the new GDP numbers have come out, the employment numbers have come out. We'll talk about all of that, but let's just take a look at some of the mega challenges that she faces.
Nirmala Sitharaman, the first woman finance minister of India and the only woman in India's topmost five-member security group. Her 11-year-old political career graph is in sharp contrast to the economy, which is staring at a slowdown. Within hours of Sitharaman taking charge, GDP data showed that growth at 6.8% was down to the slowest in the last 5 years at 6.8%. The GDP growth for the last quarter, January to March, fell below 6%, and unemployment is at 6.1%, highest in 45 years, confirming previous controversial reports. While the government maintains that as the new survey uses a different methodology, these numbers are not strictly comparable to previous surveys. The report itself compares the new data to previous NSSO job surveys. Agricultural sector growth slowed to 2.9%, down from 5% last year. The GDP growth for the last quarter, January to March, fell below 6%, and unemployment is at 6.1%, highest in 45 years. This was a controversial report before the elections, but now the government has confirmed it. Agricultural sector growth slowed down to 2.9%.
That bit of slowdown which is continuing, but from the second quarter onwards, we expect the growth in the consumption to come up. And even at 6.8%, we are the fastest growing.
In fact, the first cabinet meeting of the second Modi government focused primarily on the economic welfare for poor and vulnerable sections of the society, especially farmers. The cabinet discussed extending 6,000 rupees a year, cash out to all farmers under the PM Kisan scheme, something that was seen as an important factor in the BJP's huge win, the farmer pension scheme, and providing free LPG connections to all poor households. However, for all these expenditures, the new finance minister needs to improve tax revenues, which have fallen short of the government's targets. Fiscal deficit numbers released today are a rude reminder of this. At 3.4% of the GDP, it just about met the government's target, even though the government had revised the target upwards a few months ago.
Other economic headwinds include unemployment, falling exports, low domestic investment and consumption, and rising cost of oil. Crude oil, in fact, had recently hit a six-month high.
However, the most critical reform businesses want in land and labour, but these are also the most politically sensitive.
I would personally say let's start with a clean slate and let's take this as a ground zero. What that we've released does compare, but with a rider, with an explanatory note.
In fact, the first cabinet meeting of the new Modi government focused primarily on the economic welfare of the poor and the vulnerable sections of the society, especially the farmers.
With Maria Malavi and Himanshu Shekhar Mishra, Shruti Menon for NDTV.
Well, since that story, a very important announcement has been made. So one of the first decisions made by the new union cabinet, who had their first meeting today, a pension scheme, a very significant one, not just for farmers, but also for traders. I'll bring in my colleague Sunil Prabhu in a moment, but I'd also like to introduce my other panelists, Dr. Arvind Virmani, former chief economic advisor to the government. Also, Pooja Mehra, the senior economic journalist. Thank you both very much for being with us. But Sunil, let me come to you first. It sounds interesting, 3,000 rupees a month for farmers, which they can collect at the age of 60, assuming they apply for the scheme between the age of 18 and 40. And then there is a scheme for traders as well, for retailers, a pension scheme. But Sunil, where does the government intend to get the funds to actually get schemes like this, which would otherwise be fairly costly, to work?
Well, they Vishnu, they want to reach out to basically vulnerable sections. And the reason for why the government has decided to do it is a calculative way of ensuring that its vote bank, in particular, the retailers, as you pointed out, those who have been marginalized, who haven't had an extremely good growth rate, especially because of GST. So they've ensured that those who are below the GST turnover, 1.5 crores, between 18 and 40, can enroll for the scheme, and they will get 3,000 rupees per month with an equally matching contribution that will come from the Government of India for this. This will meet approximately 3 crores small-scale traders as well as shopkeepers. And in the similar fashion for retailers, they're quite sure that they will be able to raise the finances in the next 4 to 5 years. This is a period of over five to six years. They've even increased the extended PM Kisan Yojana already, which will now cost nearly 87,000 crores. The other one, which is the pension scheme for farmers, approximately 10,500 crores. And this scheme itself is going to cost a huge amount of funds because it's a contributory exercise with the Government of India giving it more funds. So their calculation is to broaden their vote bank, broaden those bases, keep to their promises and start delivering from day one. And that's the reason why we have seen the government take these decisions.
No, but Sunil, just a point of clarification.
Cabinet meeting,
just a point, Sunil, a point of clarification. You mentioned that it's a contributory scheme. So is there a suggestion that the retailers actually contribute a part which the government would match? Or is this just a handout from the government?
Yes, the government will match, make a matching contribution to the subscription account. So, for example, if a person is approximately 29 years of age and contributes 100 rupees, then the government shall contribute an equal amount per month for this pension scheme. This will help.
And is there
basically
an upper
traders,
cap? What is the upper cap, Sunil? Do you have
them.
Detail on that?
So if you put
what the upper cap is in terms of what a person contributes, which the government would be willing to replicate?
Yeah, no, there is no upper cap, but a minimum monthly pension will be there of 3,000 rupees. It's for people between 18 years and 40 years. So there's a cap in the sense that you can't, if you're beyond 40 years, you won't get that. Definitely, there's some kind of social security for those shopkeepers and retailers who have been the core vote bank of the BJP, the trading community in particular.
All right, let me just get a quick comment from Dr. Arvind Virmani. Dr. Virmani, two very important schemes. A lot of people would have expected this to be announced during the election period, the election run, but it's been announced now, very significant. It's going to be costly, expensive, don't you think, since it's the farming community and also the trading community which are going to benefit?
Actually, if you look at the GDP numbers, what it seems to suggest to me, if you look closely behind the headlines of the declining growth annual and the quarterly, what I see is a shift actually in the last quarter of government from investment to consumption. Mm-hmm. So perhaps in the first quarter of the current year, which we have already started, that shift will continue. I think if growth is to be re-established, that will have to be corrected. So yes, I would be very worried of either an expansion of the fiscal deficit or further shifts away from investment into consumption. Now, having said that, I've just heard you on the TV right now.
Yeah, we've just this has just come in now. We haven't even got the entire press release. Yeah, it's just happened in the last 20 minutes or so.
So the pension scheme. So pension scheme actually is comes into effect much later. So. In fact, there may be no effect on this year's consumption and fiscal deficit. So if that is true, then of course it will not matter for the purpose for which I just indicated to you.
Yeah. Pooja Mehra, let me just ask you about some of the other numbers which are coming out or which have come out today. The GDP growth numbers are, it's come down substantially. It's down to under 6%. And the reason for that is agriculture, 2017-2018, it was 5% growth. It's now 2.9%. Mining and quarrying down to 1.3% from 5.1%. So how are these huge concerns for Nirmala Sitharaman as she goes forward in her new role?
I think the new finance minister is getting into her new job in face of extreme challenges. You're quoting the annual figures, but if you look at the quarterly figures also released today, the agriculture GVA in the fourth quarter of last year, that is in the 3 months January to March, is negative 0.1%. So clearly agricultural distress is beginning to show in the national income statistics released today. The manufacturing growth is also, GVA growth is also down to just 3.1%, I think, if I'm not wrong. There's a slowdown in all the other sectors of the economy as well. And these are numbers that are the worst numbers in the last 5 years. On a quarterly basis, this is the slowest growth in 20 quarters. And this is despite no external shock. It's not like the economy has had any shock. So these numbers are coming out of clearly policy failures, and because long-term structural imbalances in the economy, the structural problems of the economy have not received adequate policy attention. And this is a cumulative result of successive governments failing to correct these structural problems, introduce big ticket reforms, land reforms, labor reforms, agrarian reforms, a complete lack of understanding of why the economy is going through this slowdown.
Sure.
And an over-reliance all the time on monetary policy and fiscal policy related solutions. So I think being an economist, somebody who has technical training in the subject, Nirmala Sitharaman is ideally placed to discuss these issues with trained economists. She has a team of economists now, the chief economic advisor is there. She should, I think, make a big case to the prime minister for long pending reforms that have not been taken up since 1991.
Sure.
And that alone can pull us out in a meaningful way from this slowdown. It's going to take time. It's
yep.
not going to happen overnight.
Okay.
But this is not something which will, you know, band-aid kind of solutions are going to address this, fix
all
this.
All right. Fair enough, Pooja. So you raise a lot of points over there. Obviously, it's going to be difficult going forward. I need to take a short break at this stage. And after that, I'm going to look at the one ministry we haven't touched so far, the Defense Ministry. Rajnath Singh from Home is now moved to the Defense Ministry. What are some of the big challenges that he faces? Welcome back. Well, let's just look at my ministry, the one that I cover, the one that Rajnath Singh is now the Home Minister, is now the Defense Minister of. He's moved from the Home Ministry to the Defense Ministry. The Defense Ministry has multiple challenges. India in the process of a profound, deep change in our armed forces and how they operate. Rajnath Singh has a great deal of experience in the Home Ministry. He's seen to have been somebody who's become quite close to the working and the functioning of the central paramilitary forces. Will he be able to do the same with the armed forces? Here's my report.
My Rajnath Singh.
It may not be the number two appointment in the government, but being defense minister of the fourth most powerful military in the world is no small matter. When Rajnath Singh crosses the road tomorrow from north to south block, he'll have his work cut out. India's armed forces are in the midst of a profound overhaul. Mr. Singh will need to work towards building an integrated modern force, possibly being commanded by a new chief of defense staff. The government needs to simplify its policy of working with the private sector, notably by removing confusion over the strategic partnership policy, which is a key part of its flagship Make in India agenda. The new government will perhaps most importantly need to find billions of dollars to fund a deep upgrade from fighter jets to submarines to air defense systems. Finally, he'll need to build capacity to be able to fight a two-front war against Pakistan and China. This will be a huge challenge.
Decision-making has been alarmingly slow in the Defence Ministry. An internal MOD note accessed by NDTV last year said of 144 deals in the three financial years prior to 2018, only 8 to 10% fructified in the stipulated time period, with multiple diffuse structures with no single point accountability being a big impediment in the decision-making process. Mr. Singh will need to wade through this red tape to make decision-making quick and efficient, a task that no defense minister in India's history has been able to fully implement. Vishnu Shom for NDTV. Well, let's just get some final comments from Mrs. Kumaramangalam. Ma'am, you know, the Defence Ministry is a difficult ministry because, you know, there's a lot of technology issues which one has to grasp. There is basic economics and complex economics that one needs to grasp. There are three services plus the Coast Guard as well. It's very, very difficult. The learning curve is very, very steep. This itself would be a challenge, wouldn't it, for Rajnath Singh?
Absolutely. But it would have been a challenge for any defense minister. Let's be very honest here. India is a very complicated defense sector. You have the overland security like CPRF, BSF and all of them. Aside from that, the three services. And India has a huge coastline. So we are not looking just at army security, but maritime and air security, given the fact that Pakistan and China are sort of nipping at our heels all the time. And I quite agree with you. Financing of the modernization of not just the army, but the navy and the air force also is going to require a huge amount of funds. But I don't think this is the responsibility only of the defense minister, chiefly of the defense minister, yes. But we have a very cohesive team now at the top.
Right.
As pointed out by you earlier, Vishnu, that Mr. Jaishankar, Nirmala ji, Amit ji, Modi ji and Rajnath ji and Gadkari ji, by the way, Nitin ji, all of them are extremely practical and in their own way very good at their own jobs.
Right.
So I'm sure that it will undoubtedly be a difficult job. I'm not going to say it's a cakewalk because that will not be even true. But I'm sure that they will rise to the occasion, but it will take time.
Absolutely.
Let's not presume that it's going to all happen overnight. But I think the Prime Minister and his team are very well aware that this is an issue that must be addressed.
Absolutely.
And they will do it.
All right, ma'am. I'd like to thank you very much for joining us. I'm completely out of time. Well, you finally have it, that big long list of ministers. It's out. We just dealt with, I think, that much of this list. But there are pages and pages of very, very interesting appointments. And, you know, one hasn't even gotten into the alliance partners who've been given posts, who's been left out. But as you can see over there on your screen, the big four, Amit Shah, Nirmala Sitharaman, Rajnath Singh and Dr. Jaishankar. Those are the top four. We've had a look at what they bring to the table. What's this government going to do? Take a break. Stay tuned for more.